mit Closer. Letzte Goal. Okay. Perl 6. Great stuff like asynchronous I.O., auto-parallelization, multiple syntaxes in one program and so on. And this is probably why we are all here. It's the name of an open-minded, strong, collaborating community. You. Hope so. It's not Perl 4. Yes, we've seen there was a Perl 4. It's not the same. It's not the same as Perl 5. And it's not to be intended to be a drop-in replacement. It's just new language. And it's no continuity of the status quo. We have in the Perl 6 ecosystem, Racudo. It's a Perl 6 compiler targeting MoreVM, JVM, and nowadays also JavaScript. It's Perl 6 specification conform, and it's one of many Perl 6 implementations. Even it's probably the most famous one. And Racudo Star is a bundle of the Perl 6 compiler, Racudo, and some created Perl 6 core modules. It's that what Perl 5 calls core module. In Perl 6, it's just created modules bundled with the compiler. We will see. And Perl, Racudo Star is that what you might install as Perl. Okay. How to get them? Just go to Racudo.org files, choose your operating system. Some people may have Windows, then choose Windows. And follow the installation instructions for your operating system or Windows. Yeah, well, this is not a joke. A lot of companies I work in have a department for operating systems and databases and Windows and Intel. That's the difference. Okay. After you have installed your compiler, you can simply run Perl 6 and your Perl 6 program. You can add a shebang line on the top of the Perl 6 program, add the executable flag, and then simply run it as usual. It's like any other language which can pass the program code on its own. You can run the Perl 6 program with parameters. You can do it the same way when you have self-contained scripts. And you can start, you can give the Perl 6 parameters either here or here. Those parameters are specified here. You have a detailed option reference later on this page, so scroll down a little bit. And that's one part where Racudo is not that specification conform. Some of the parameters are implemented, even if they are referred as won't. And some options are not implemented. So Perl 6 --help will give you the latest information. That's probably at the very moment important. It's also in flow. So it is to expect that some parameters are implemented in the next few months. And in difference then it's done in former Perl times. You have a Perl 6 minus debug, for example, to instead of Perl minus D. Okay. What's most important for Perl has always been the one-liners. Because there's always a Perl on your system and you can always do one-liners because, well, it's there. So it's, well, from my perspective, the goal, what we should have, we should have Perl 6 in user bin Perl to be always there. Okay. This line looks more or less similar to the original line. But the next one, line ending tidy, which is very complicated in Perl 5, is done easily in Perl 6 because, well, it's built in. So some one-liners are very short. Another famous is, for example, filtering. You can run Perl 6 minus n for execute line by line and then run on dollar underscore and skip the dollar underscore and have an easy expression. And what I'm surprised that this is important, but it was number 6 or 7 on the most used Perl one-liners. Okay, the line in the command line has not the same constraints like on a slide, so you can continue here. And the terminal will help you scrolling or wrapping line, whatever. And yeah, that is a one-liner adding some line numbers to an input file in Perl 6. That's a little bit longer in Perl 6 than in Perl 5. On the other way, it's much cleaner to understand. I think everyone in the room immediately understand what this code does. I don't know if it's still true. This is the same stuff, but it makes the line numbers only as wide as they need it. That's done here. But usually you know approximately how many lines you have. Okay, that's for the examples in the day-by-day stuff. And now we are going to, let's say, understand a little bit code. And we are starting with strings because Perl is for text processing. So we have here a very simple literal string and it's processed exactly as is written. Here we have a string which is completely interpolated, which means we have a dollar star pit here instead of previously famous dollar dollar, because it's not supported anymore. And we get here the number of the process we are currently running in. And here we have a string containing some letters and we increment it and we get an incremented string. So this is what an increment postfix operator does on every string finally. And here docs are changed to, you have a Q colon 2 and then the terminator of your here doc. You can choose, they are coming later to it, a lower or an upper Q, depending whether you want your HereDoc interpolated or not. But at the very moment, there's nothing in it what can or what needs to be interpolated. So I'm choosing the queue. Okay. Now we have a completely interpolated string, which has a lot of, well, more or less famous letters you might or might not know, but we are here to learn them closer. These are C special characters, and finally your C library will do special things when you print them out. So, the first character, backslash A, bless you, is at position 0 and is one character width. And when you dump it, then backslash A is shown. When you print it using say or print, your terminal bells. At the very last character, that's star minus 1, a new line character is shown. In opposite to Perl 5, you have to add the star before the minus 1, because it should not happen accidentally that you have a variable containing a negative value, which then takes characters from the end of the string. This is intended and not by accident. You can pass also a range to substring and then get, in this example, the tab character. And when you fetch one character, then the range ends where it starts. That's probably also important for ranges. And here is another example. You fetch from position 15 till the 12th position from the end. This is not relative, this is absolute. When you are using negative positions in substring, it's always absolute. Okay, the next one, string attributes. We have a typical Unicode character who didn't type it day by day. Yeah. This is how it looks like when you say it. And when you get the characters in this string, you get one. This is one character. It has four codes. When you encode it, in this case, it's default to UTF-8. You get 14 bytes. And when you encode it in UTF-16, you get 12 bytes. But there is no bytes in a string. A string has characters, codes, words, whatever. But it's not a system language. You don't get memory information. Okay, but we want to do something. So, very first, we want to query some stuff from database. So, we have here a little string, capital Q, with nested delimiters, so brackets. This is nested. So you can put as much open brackets in the string as long as you close it. You can, you have here slash delimiting the string. Q is also literal string, not interpolated, but colon x executed. Then colon vv, www, split on words with quote protection. So if your ls returns something with shell quoting, it's respected. And then it's put in the array f. Then we have an interpolated string, almost, but this is not nested because the open is missing. So you have to escaping. Yeah, misplaced delimiters or whatever, how you can see it from the parser perspective. And double Q is fully interpolated, but you can exclude stuff, for example, when you're using colon exclamation mark. In this example, we do not interpolate hashes. This is probably when you have a hash 0, then it's not interpolated. When you have a hash s, it's not interpolated. When you miss the exclamation mark h and you have one of those, this string will not contain %s, it will contain the content of your entire hash. But our f, elements of it and the characters in it, we want to have interpolated. So this is a %0 leaded. Then length of string d and something else. So we can exactly say how wide is our integer, which is printed later. We still have the character conversion and the ordinary. And we get it in our example from every code point. So use it on, how it's said, Unicode wisely. You can concatenate strings, but in Perl 6, the string operators are using tilde instead of plain dot or whatever. And we come later to it, the number is using a plus there. And we had it in the talk of Sawyer this morning, we have an uppercase, title case, and lowercase. But unless in Perl 5, this is fully Unicode support. So if I would have Greek letters here, they would be uppercased correctly. So yeah, write down for the next example, add Greek letters. And some text processing. At first, we want to use regular expressions. Okay, it's a bad example for explaining. We have our typical hello world, then we are taking the first one from here. Then we are replacing some letters. And finally, we are replacing substring RV. This is unlike in Perl 5, you have to use a minus RV when you have a left value, which should be modifiable, and replace world by Perlcon. And then we get a very complicated greet Perlcon. But I think it should explain a lot of things you can do to text and strings. Okay, numbers. The very first, we have four ways to note our first million, because it's the most difficult thing to get your first. So we have more than one way. The underscores in the example doesn't carry any semantic information. It's just for readability. That's because Perl is difficult to read. The hexadecimal notation doesn't change much. It's 0x leading, and then write your hex number. Octal is changed, has changed from leading 0 to 0o, like 0x, to have a little bit more readable is not what I mean. It's always a similar consistency. Yes, consistency was the word. So when you're choosing a different base, it's more consistent. But you can also get arbitrary bases. That's an exercise. What the number is. So okay. And I don't know how it's in Perl 5. This is not a literal number. It's an unary operator applied to a literal number. This is important when you use arithmetics on it. We will see it here a little bit later, because Perl 6 natively supports complex literal numbers. So we can simply show the square root of minus 1. We can have an imaginary part only. We can have generic order cologne as complex. We can have an infinite imaginary part. We can also have an infinite real part, but that's pretty common, everyone can have it. The negative one is, like the plus here, it's an operation. You see it when you multiply it. You get here the multiplication of the real part, and the imaginary part remains 2. So use the literal notation, and then you get the correct value. And we have to change the title. Okay. Bigger feature of Perl 6 is you can write constants by their name. So you can write a shortened constant, you can get a function returning the real value, or you can just use the built-in constant. You can use also tau to avoid multiplying p. You can use the Euler number. And you can write rational numbers as they are, but when they are printed, Perl tries when it can be printed as a decimal number, it will do. Only when it's not possible, then it will reprint the rational . You can, of course, compare numbers with all the operators you might need. You can do some binary arithmetic on it. You can use prefix, postfix, and other unary operators. You can use binary operators. But unlike in Perl 5 or C or Pascal or whatever, here you have the difference. You have to put a plus in front instead of just have two less or two greater and so on. You can simply add a superscripted number for direct powering arbitrary bases. This makes it easy to write a very large prime number directly into your code for use on daily basis. Then we come to conditionals. That's pretty much the same as in most other languages. The first line, we have a very easy if-else statement. We can, of course, omit the else statement. When you have a block where something, then you can use if, else if, and else to distinguish a little bit more. You can use statement modifier. You can use unless also here, but unless does not have an else. So it's probably not that reasonable in that case. And you can also use if as a statement modifier. And then you get the correct results. You can use or abbreviate some blocks using with. With is like if, but instead of proving whether the expression is true or false, it's proving whether the expression is defined or not. So, and indifference, if does not use dollar underscore. If simply evaluates the expression and lets you alone with whatever you want to do in your block or statement, with evaluates the block, whether it's defined or not, and the result is set into dollar underscore, which always can be omitted by, for example, simply add a dot. The opposite of with is without. So when you say without any or true, any is not defined, and then you get very likely a roll again. When we have a small routine which does return an undefined value unless you have a road for a prime number, then you get with prime only here. You get only a defined number when you are in this return path. And when you are getting in this return path, you put with a pointy block notation the return value instead of dollar underscore in dollar $n, and in the block after it you can use dollar $n. This can be useful when you want to nest blocks or when you have more readable code, when your block is a little bit larger. You can, like with if and else if, have multiple define proofs using with and always. So in a case you roll from A to G and you find an A, oops, you can say after you find an A that you have to say B. You can check whether one said A before B and otherwise refuse because you have to say A or B. The next one is given. Given just takes the result and put it in dollar underscore. It doesn't prove anything at the moment. You have to prove later with whens or the else respectively default. And when you have such an expression, and for 2, 3, and 7, simply return the result of the polynom when you get the answer to the ultimate question of life, universe, and everything. You have a 20% chance to get any, and you have a 20% chance that the state machine is complaining because you didn't use with. Any when or default block immediately leaves the outer block when the inner block has been finished. So in this example, when you have a 60% chance for the numbers, int is true. It says, well, found an int computing, and then leaves the outer block. So you get nothing more than, so you wait for a computing result maybe forever. Depends. Same is for the string to check. The statement modifier, we don't have it here, just for information, the statement modifier won't leave the outer block. But there is no inner block in the statement modifier. So. And to get out of this serious problem, you have a proceed or succeed. When you have a proceed, then it's like the fall through statement. Well, there is no fall through, it's mostly a comment. So you have an implicit break, as said, and proceed removes that break. So when you are coming into the int line and proceed, the next whens are proceeded. You don't know in which when you're coming. It's not a fall through. You can reach every one of that. For string, you know in this example where you're coming into. But the succeed in our default now ensures that the state machine is no longer complaining. Because the succeed at this position leaves the default block immediately and then leaves the outer block And everyone is happy. Okay, let's come to the last part, that are loops. We have the typical for stuff. So we have a small array, and for each element, just say. So we loop over the elements, call the block for each of one, executing it, and going to the next. Then we have a similar loop, but we have here a special pointy block, which also writes the result back. Okay. So for each element, put the element in $n, not in $_, increments it, and write it back. This one is read-only, but it takes two elements in one run, and a default in case the second element is not available in a list of three elements. So, it's a little bit cheated. So, you might get something like this output. In this case, when you have four elements and sort the list, you can also run for two elements by using $caret and a variable. This is a shortcut for the pointy block, and the variables, instead of here in order of appearance, are filled in alphabetically order. So it's not the first one ever evaluated first. It's in alphabetical order. Put it in and then passed as coming. Then, instead of using loop in different syntax notations, the well famous C loop is using the loop statement. So we have an initializer, a state, an expression which is evaluated whether it's true or not, and something which is executed every round and then executing the block. You can write infinite loops, but instead of writing bracket, semicolon, semicolon, bracket, you can just omit it and then have an infinite loop. You can get the results from the loop back. So you can run a loop, do some expressions here, and write the result back to L. And then process L. Or you put it in a list and process the list immediately. So this might be the most interesting one for the one-liners. Okay. While loops are run as long as the expression evaluates to true. The expression is evaluated before the block is executed, so the block might be entirely skipped. This is not reasonable for debug code or initializing stuff which has to be run, then while is the wrong solution. And you can use while as statement modifier too. We are a little bit short on time, otherwise I would ask you what the output is, but we don't get it. Until it's the opposite of while, it runs as long as the expression evaluates to false. So it's also evaluated before the block is executed. It can skip also the entire block, but, well, until the expression evaluates to false. And it can be used as statement modifier too. When you need a block must be run at least once, then use repeat while or repeat until, then it's at least incremented once, until it's true, or as long as it's false. So you get 10, 11, 100. Any questions in the last minute? A module that would work with both. I would say, in the meaning of the question, no, it's not, and it's not sane. There are different languages, but you can write program code which can run in Perl 5 and in Perl 6. When you Google it, Elizabeth Mathiesen has wrote a lot of ecosystem stuff which allows you to have existing Perl 5 code running in Perl 6. And I would say, from what I understand from both languages, it catches 99.9%. So it's a good chance that your code will run simply out of the box with the right modules loaded. That's four.
Four. Yeah, that's what I heard. The A and B, for example, there. The third. Yeah. So they're not carrying nine? Is that,
in this,
is that okay?
In the pointer block notation, you don't have to write my, as far as I know. Maybe JJ knows better. Do we need a my here?
No.
I don't think, no. I don't think, but I'm not sure. Wouldn't. Okay. It's. Yeah. This A and B belongs only to this block.
Yeah.
This is the pointy block notation, and it belongs only to here. It's not defined after the statement. Yeah, I don't want to get that much into because, well, I have only 45 minutes. In fact, it evaluates to a subroutine declaration implicit with that signature and the variable names. It's the same for the string. The substring examples. The star minus one also. It evaluates to code, and giving a code parameter will cause the substring, evaluates the code, and uses the return value. it's a overloaded function and can handle multiple definitions. But I think this is maybe too far for let's just use and do the right thing. Any other questions? I know, but yeah, then? I do not understand the question. Not from. Can you, do you understand what he means? Okay. Maybe explain me later. I just don't understand it. So, okay. Then we are 5 minutes late. Thank you for your time.